two programming paradigms. I already put forth to you that there is a need of programming paradigm. Okay, so there is no question that you understand now that programming paradigms, or to understand programming paradigms, is necessary in order to understand what are the similarities, what are the differences between different programming languages and how they implement programming concepts in it. Okay, so the whole idea of this subject revolves around two distinct programming styles. One is called as a declarative style of programming, and the other one is referred to as the imperative style of programming. Okay, most of you who are familiar with C programming language, which you see over here in this slide, which is categorized as one of the imperative programming style. Okay, there are only two different styles of programming, but there are further divisions in these two categories. So I can start off saying that if I am developing a new programming language, it will either be of a declarative type or an imperative type. That would be the first distinction that I would make. Further, I would also say, if it's declarative, is it functional programming, is it data flow driven programming, or is it logic constraint based programming? So there are various ways in which I can subdivide the category of declarative programming languages. Okay, we will look into every subcategory as well as the category, and understand why these categories are made and what is the necessity of having these categories. But first of all, just understand, if I have a spectrum of all programming languages, I can classify them into two categories. One is the declarative category, the other one is imperative category of programming languages. Yeah, I hope my voice and the screen both are visible and audible respectively. Anybody can just say that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the response. Now, the declarative style of programming can further be divided into three categories, or subcategories, I could say, depending on how these declarative programming languages are structured. Okay, one is called as functional, the other one is called as data flow driven, the third one is called as logic or constraint based. So these are the three subcategories, and these are, please understand, are not the only categories, but these are very much important categories of declarative programming languages. Further, when we turn to imperative kind of programming languages, we see that they are further subdivided into von Neumann languages, or which generally are referred to as structured programming languages. That's the first category. Second one is object oriented, and the third one is scripting. So if you think of a broader sense, that whatever programming language you choose from will actually be fitting in one of these six broader subcategories. So if I choose one programming language, say Python, as you are seeing, it is nothing but a scripting language, and it is broadly an imperative programming language. Okay, so if I choose, say, one programming language called as SQL, structured query language, which is the language for querying a database that you are going to learn in this semester, this SQL language, programming language, is under the category of logic or constraint programming. So it is actually a constraint based programming, because in the database you have certain data stored in a tabular manner, and in using structured query language, what you are doing is you are querying a subset of data based on certain constraints that you require the data to have. That's why it is coming under the constraint based programming language, under the category of declarative programming language. Now, what is the main distinction between the two broader categories that we talked about, declarative and imperative? Consider that you are coding a C program, and you are writing a program in C to find out GCD of a number, which is there over here on the screen. So you are writing a function in C. This particular function that you are looking at is a function that finds out greatest common divisor between two numbers. Now, what is GCD and all, we are not caring about at this moment, but just understand how exactly this particular code looks like. This code tells my machine that I want to find GCD between two integers A and B, and the resultant would be an integer. So the function name suggests that the return value is integer, input is integer, second input is integer, and after specifying that, what we do is we write down the steps using which you can convert given numbers into their GCD. So we actually write steps in order to get the output. So we are writing these steps as algorithmic steps in order to obtain the output. So a program that finds out GCD of two numbers in C programming language generally is set of steps that are required if you give input two numbers and get GCD out of it. And these steps will be followed by your hardware as they are specified. And this way, the imperative way of programming means that you are telling the hardware or instructing the hardware to do certain instructions in a specific manner. Now that specific manner could organize your code in a structured way. That specific manner can organize your code in an object-oriented fashion, or that specific set of steps may be just a list of different steps, irrespective of any particular programming organization. Agar aapke jo steps hai, wo function ya subroutine blocks mein organized hai, just like C program, we write multiple functions and then we write a main function where we call those subroutines in order to execute the code. तो सी की तरह वो लिखा तो उसको वॉन न्यूमन लैंग्वेज बोला जाता है या स्ट्रक्चर्ड प्रोग्रामिंग लैंग्वेज बोला जाता है. अगर आपने जावा की तरह ऑब्जेक्ट ओरिएंटेड फैशन में कोड को स्पेसिफाई किया, कोड के इंस्ट्रक्शंस को लिखा, तो दैट इज रेफर्ड टू एज ऑब्जेक्ट ओरिएंटेड बिकॉज एंटायर प्रोग्राम इज रिवॉल्विंग अराउंड क्लासेस विच स्टोर डेटा and which has functions to manipulate the data. So if that is the way of looking at or giving or specifying the code, then it is referred to as object-oriented programming. Third category is scripting. So scripting is a much more, I can say, relaxed variant of the way we write the program. In C, to begin writing main function, you need to follow a lot of syntactical details, like telling what is the return type, then telling the name of the function, then putting parentheses and between parentheses writing all the arguments or all the parameters of that function. Every parameter name should proceed with the data type that it has. So all these details are required when you are writing a C function's definition. Then you need to write the open parenthesis, curly brace, closing curly brace, and in between that you need to write the details of what that function needs to do on the input and how it produces the return value and how it returns the value. ये सब आपको C में करना पड़ता है. Block constructs लिखने पड़ते हैं. Block constructs नहीं, जो curly brace में लिखते हो उसको generally block constructs बोला जाता है. So there is a specific syntax provided apart from the actual instructions that the hardware needs to execute. Whereas when you go for scripting language, much of these extra syntactical details, they are missing. They are relaxed. So the code is in a relaxed form. Hence, there is no need for the programmer to remember a lot of non-essential details of the programming language. Okay, so that is the benefit of writing scripting language. It's very much flexible how you organize your code. You have facilities which otherwise would be not possible in a blocked programming language, which is like object-oriented or structured. Object-oriented mein bhi syntactical details bahut zyada the. Ulte object-oriented mein syntactical details badh jate hai because you not only now think of organizing the steps to solve the problem, but you now start thinking about how to organize the entire set of input data or the contained data in the program in terms of some class representation. So you have to think a lot while designing the program solution when it comes to object-oriented programming. But Saying so, object-oriented programming is essentially very good for solving real-world problems, because most of the real-world problem, it is easy to abstract the data or the information that you want to represent in your program into a class and then using its object to perform operations on that data. Okay, so object-oriented programming क्या करता है? कोई real-world scenario में वो identify करता है कि क्या-क्या data component है, क्या-क्या attributes है, and then it tries to organize the various attributes, various data into an organized form called as a class, and then I can get that class object some instant value for the variables to generate and representation in the program. Now, the whole programming language is organized around how you manipulate the variables in which are present. So, class ka concept agar aapko pata nahi hai at this moment, because some of you might not know any other programming language than C, we will be learning this in module 2. So, don't worry about a thing or two that you can't understand exactly when I'm speaking today. But module number 2 will exactly know what I'm actually trying to mean. Just itna yaad rakho, jab main structured programming mein koi code likhta hoon, to mera viewpoint kaise hota hai? Agar main aapko bolun ki you need to write a subroutine or you need to write a program, C program, to find out GCD of two numbers, to aap kya sochoge? Aap sochoge do numbers ka GCD mujhe create karna hai, to mere paas do input hai और मेरे पास GCD है दो नंबर का, जो मेरा आउटपुट है. अगर दो इंटीजर्स हैं तो उसका आउटपुट भी इंटीजर्स रहेगा. नेक्स्ट थिंग यू थिंक अबाउट इज GCD निकालने के लिए या GCD को कैलकुलेट करने के लिए व्हाट आर द स्टेप्स, एंड यू विल ट्राई टू राइट दो स्टेप्स इन टर्म्स ऑफ सीक्वेंस ऑफ सी इंस्ट्रक्शंस और सम सॉर्ट ऑफ कंट्रोल फ्लो स्ट्रक्चर जस्ट लाइक इफ एल्स और मे बी सम सॉर्ट ऑफ लूपिंग कंस्ट्रक्ट्स or some sort of functional calls using which you will implement your entire code. So that is how you think of calculating GCD of two numbers when it comes to a structured programming language. But when object-oriented programming language actually tries to tackle certain problem, so this problem is very easy to solve. Isliye isme kuch object ya class nahi hai finding GCD of two numbers. But then say suppose I want to implement a very complex system like a library management system, maybe. Then I want to actually write a module in it wherein a book is issued to a student. Ek book student ko issue karna hai. To mere paas bahut sara information abhi rahega. Mere pure library mein kitne sare books hai, usme se kitne books issued hai, kitne books issued nahi hai. Jo issued book hai unka issue date kya hai, unka return date kya hai, jo book issue nahi hai wo kab return aaye the, and all lot of other information is required. Now, keeping this entire information in unstructured manner is very much difficult. So what object-oriented programming language does is it tries to represent certain objects in this particular problem. So main kya kya objects yahan identify kar sakta hu? I can identify an object called as a book. I can identify an object called as a student who is accessing the book. I can identify an object called as an administrator who is allowing that student to get that particular book. And now once I visualize my real world scenario like this, I will try to represent in a structured manner, okay, like a class. So structure ek facility hai structured programming language mein, structure in the sense of C programming construct called as structure, jo aapke last chapter mein rahega agar aapne sikha hoga to स्ट्रक्चर में क्या करते हो आप? सिर्फ एट्रीब्यूट्स हैं उनको कलेक्ट करते हो. लेकिन इन ऑब्जेक्ट ओरिएंटेड प्रोग्रामिंग व्हाट यू कैन डू इन अ क्लास इज नॉट ओनली यू कैन कंस्ट्रक्ट दी वेरिएबल्स टुगेदर एज वन सिंगल यूनिट एज अ डिराइव्ड डेटा टाइप. अलोंग विद दैट यू कैन स्टोर सर्टन फंक्शनैलिटीज विच मैनिपुलेट दीज वेरिएबल्स. सो दैट इज रेफर्ड टू एज अ क्लास. एंड नाउ यूजिंग दिस हायर ऑर्डर रिप्रेजेंटेशन I can now create different objects and manipulate them in order to solve the problem. Essentially, my solution again requires me to instruct the computer what exactly it needs to do to manipulate the data which is present now inside the object. Okay, so structured programming language, data ko khula chhodte hai. In the program we just declare the data, use the data wherever we want. As at most what we can do is we can create user defined data types like structure, union, using which we can organize data as a single coherent unit. But the function which manipulate the data are segregated or separate from the structure itself, whereas in object orientation what we try to do is we try to organize the data and the functions that manipulate data together in a single capsule like structure, which is generally referred to as a object when it is executed.